I know, it doesn't.
I think it's mean it doesn't sound like much. I tend to have a really low voice.
Is that better?
Okay, can you guys hear me with that? They stopped listening, I know. Can you guys hear me with that, okay?
Yep.
All right, great, thank you. Well, good afternoon and welcome to the 2017 Spring Series of Booked for Lunch. We're glad to see you. It was a little nippy walking in here and a little windy, so we appreciate the fact that you made it across the big yard and in. We do have Scott Peters as our opening author of the series today. And I know what it says on the flyer is Paul Chafee for Station 11. And Paul called me last week and he had a death in the family. So he's out of the state for this week and possibly part of next week. So, Scott, I saw speak 2 weeks ago at Saginaw Valley State University where he won a wonderful award in literature from them. And I thought I would love to have this man speak at Booked for Lunch in the fall. Not knowing that we would have an opportunity even sooner to have him speak today. So we thank him very much for being able to come in and fill in today and just a little sooner than we thought we would. Mr. Peters lives in Flint and is the curator of collections for the Michigan Historical Museum, so he has a wonderful, fun job. He has a Bachelor of Arts in History from U of M Flint and a Master's degree in History and Museum Studies from Case Western University. In 2016, Scott's book, Making Waves, Michigan's Boat Building Industry from 1865 to 2000, was chosen as a Michigan Notable Book, a distinction given every year by the Library of Michigan, and each selected title speaks to our state's rich cultural, historical, and literary heritage. And Scott also received the Stuart and Bernice Gross Award for Excellence in Literature from Saginaw Valley State University just, I think, 2 weeks ago. So we're very happy to welcome you here, and I know you will enjoy this talk, and we can all think about boat building and boats and getting warm. Please welcome Scott.
Do you mind the lights off in the front?
Yeah. I'd like to thank Trish and also Kirsten for inviting me today. I'm again filling in on kind of short notice, but want to make it worth your while and talk a little bit about boat building in Michigan.
Do we have these lights off here?
Yep, it'll take 10 seconds.
Our first boat builders were the Native Americans who started creating craft, and a lot of them were women boat builders. They would harvest the birch bark and also the ash flints and things like that to create the birch bark canoes. Our first kinds of boats that we had were actually work boats. These would be boats that would be on the backs of schooners, on the stern part, that would be used for transporting passengers or even goods throughout the harbors. A lot of times we had other kinds of boats that were even simple dugouts that were used in the lumber industry. One of the most popular kinds of boats in the Great Lakes region was called the Mackinaw boat. And it was a double-ended boat that originated over in Ireland called the Drontheim boat that was brought to the Great Lakes region by immigrants in about the 1830s and 1840s. And it was sort of like the pickup truck for the Great Lakes. It was a boat that could be used for commercial fishing, for hauling small cargoes, even transporting passengers from place to place. A lot of them were built and used around the Mackinaw region. That's for the name, but it was a real seaworthy type of craft. Our first form of recreational boating comes around chasing the railroads as they progressed northward throughout Michigan. We had on the east side of the state the Detroit and Mackinac Railroad, and on the west side of the state we had the Grand Rapids in Indiana. Both of them were sort of racing towards the Straits of Mackinac to develop their lines. Then we had a lot of other railroads crisscrossing the southern and central parts of the state, like the Michigan Central and Michigan Southern. And a lot of times, the resorts would follow along where the railroads had already gone. And this is a shot of Reed's Lake over by Grand Rapids. And you see all these small rowboats in the foreground, and then also some small steamers in the background that would be used to take the rowboats and fishermen out to favorite fishing spots and then retrieve them at the end of the day and bring them back. A lot of times we had early inland steamers on our waterways. So this is the Tobinabee, which is in northern Michigan. There used to be, or still is, a large channel called the Inland Waterway that goes across the northern sector of the Lower Peninsula. And it's a winding, curvy path, but a lot of folks just like to get out and about for recreation during the early years of boating in Michigan for recreational purposes for their families. It wasn't until people had a lot of available free time or also the economic means to develop recreation boating, and that starts around in the 1870s and 1880s. So again, these different boat builders would set up shop following those resort orders. We have Thomas Allen over in Spring Wells, Michigan, down by Detroit. There's even boat builders up in Marquette, such as George Pryor. You wouldn't think of Marquette as being a large yachting community, but they had three boat builders there at one time, all working at the same time because there were so many people in the mines that were making pretty decent money. And then Ira Kendricks over in Port Huron was building both rowboats and then yawl boats. So those yawl boats are the ones that the schooners would carry for transporting goods and stuff around in the harbors and all. Imagine what it was like going out on an early powered boat called a steam launch. This is a painting that we have in our collection at the museum. And what you see is a hunting party, essentially. There's a hunter that's sitting in the bow of the boat, usually sitting on top of a load of coal. And the man in the middle tends the steam engine. And this was required by federal law. You had to have a licensed steam engineer to run your boat for you. And then finally, the man on the stern is actually steering the boat sometimes. But if you can imagine, it took well over a half hour sometimes to raise the steam for the boat to go. It wasn't just turning on a key ignition or anything like that. It took quite a while. And then you had the soot coming off the chimney to dump on your body as you were preparing to shoot animals from far away. But so this was our first kind of power boating experiences with the steam launches like you see here. Now, if you were really famous or wealthy, you would sometimes have a large steam yacht. And this is one that was built called Sigma, and was built by a shipbuilder by the name of John Craig down in Trenton, Michigan. And this is about 160 plus feet long, wooden-hulled ship. They also built steel-hulled steam yachts. One of the most important early firms that got into boat building in Michigan was called Detroit Boat Works. And they even built things like electric boats for the Columbian Exposition down in Chicago in 1893. This is one of the electric launches that would weave back and forth throughout the different lagoons down that way. And it was an early form of battery-powered boat. And this company was operated by Frankie Kirby, who was the designer of a lot of the passenger steamers on the Great Lakes. One of their other boats was kind of different. This is George Baker's submarine. We built submarines here in Michigan. And this is a wooden hull submarine from, again, the 1890s that was designed by a guy by the name of George Baker. He tried to sell the design to the Navy, but unfortunately he died of appendicitis attack, I think it was, before he could actually transact the sale. But this is a wooden-hulled, cigar-shaped submarine that was actually tested on River Rouge in Michigan.
Yeah.
One of the first early incorporated companies in Michigan was called the Spring Lake Clinker Boat Manufacturing Company, which is a mile-long name for a really small firm. It had about 4 to 7 people working for the company at the time. It still is around today as Barrett Boat Works in Spring Lake, and is still in operation. But they would build small rowboats like you see in the advertisement here in the small factory, and then ship them throughout the country by rail. And so that's how they get started. And it starts in the 1880s, late 1880s for this particular firm. One of the first sort of niche industries of boat building in Michigan was actually the folding canvas boat building industry. And this is a small boat that would be collapsed down into a bag or a box and then transported to your favorite lake or place on horseback. And so either by horseback or later on by car. And this industry starts in like the 1870s and continued on up until the 1960s over in the Kalamazoo and Battle Creek area. Osgood was a jeweler, and he had a number of ladies working on sewing machines in the back of his store to actually build the canvas-covered hulls of these boats. It shows what one of them looks like assembled. It was probably a little bit tippier than it looks. The guy standing up here. This is what the boats would look like. And they became real famous during the Yukon Gold Rush because they could be transported and then used on the rivers up that way to get to the gold fields a little faster than everybody else who had to hike. One of the important first individuals in Michigan's boat building heritage is Clark Sims, who developed the two-cycle gasoline engine. Same kind of thing that's used on a lawnmower today. And he formed the Wolverine Motor Works over in Holland, Michigan. His company was eventually bought out and transferred to Detroit, where it became part of Michigan Yacht and Power Company a little bit later on. But the Sims engine was one of the first really successful gasoline engines that was used both in automobiles but also in boats. And this is a photo of one of these things. It's probably a 300 or 400 pound engine, and boats made a really good test bed for testing out these engines because they could take a lot of weight. It wasn't like an automobile. It had air in its tires or could support a lot of weight. And this was a good place for them to test them out. One of the first major manufacturing companies in the state was called Truscott Boat Manufacturing Company, and it was located over in St. Joseph, Michigan, over, again on the west side. There was actually a lot more boat building in the early years on the west side of the state than there was on the east side. And as you can see from the photograph here, they were building all sorts of different boats of different shapes and sizes. There was no real organization to how they were planning the construction of these boats. They were probably building just as the orders came in, but it kind of gives you a sense of what the early boat building plants looked like on the inside. And there's boats in all sorts of different stages of construction. And Truscott likewise would build both engines and boats. This is a launch called the Jesse, which would have a small gasoline engine in it. It would have been typically used on small lakes and rivers, but sort of looks like the African Queen of its time. One of the other large manufacturing companies was actually named after a city in Wisconsin, but was located in Muskegon. And this is their Racine Boat Manufacturing Company. And they had lost their home to a fire in 1904 in Racine. And just like the different industries in the Bay City and Saginaw area here that depended on lumber, the city of Muskegon was also looking to replace old lumber jobs after the forests were gone, and invited the company to come over to Muskegon and build its new factory right there. So they gave them a financial incentive and also lots of land right out of Muskegon Lake to build their plant. And they even built things like steel-hulled ships, like light ships that were traveling lighthouses and things like that. And also the same kind of launches that you saw at the Truscott Company earlier on. Spray here is an early 21-foot sailboat. Just because we had gasoline-powered boats at this time doesn't mean that sail ever really goes away. It lingers on and becomes actually one of the leading forms of racing in the Great Lakes region, and this was one of the champions of Great Lakes here that was active about 1905. We also built steel boats here in Michigan. This is an advertisement for the Michigan Steel Boat Company. There was a guy over in Kalamazoo who devised a process by which they could take sheets of steel and make them sort of interlock like a chimney pipe or a stove pipe would on an old coal-fired stove. And by using that same process, they could make boat hulls. And there's a few of these Michigan Steel Boat Company boats still around even to this day that were made of steel and had a small 2-horsepower engine to power them. One of the most important industries in this area is the knockdown boat building industry. And what happened was there was a gentleman here in town by the name of Clifford Brooks. And Clifford Brooks took the idea from his wife, who had been laying out patterns on top of the dining room table to sew a dress. But he took that same idea and applied it to boat building, to lay out patterns on top of pieces of wood, to cut them out, and then ship people a bundle of parts that they could reassemble elsewhere by going through mail order. And so Clifford Brooks was a guy who actually got started right here in town and became very famous as the Brooks Boat Manufacturing Company. They later get lured down to Saginaw and become famous there through some financial incentives, but he actually gets a start right here. And it's the same folks, the William Sovereigns and the folks who started Aladdin Company, actually got their start with the knockdown boat builders earlier on and take that same technology into building knockdown homes. This shows a package of parts that you could get, again, got via mail order. And these parts were shipped all over the world. Even by 1905, they were building 10,000 boats a year just in Bay City alone, and then shipping them all over the world by mail order. Brooks came up with the idea of advertising in national magazines to distribute them, and you would write for a catalog, order the boat plan that you want, and it would come to you as a package of parts like you would see here. And then you would get your friends to help build it in your backyard, let's say, or along a waterway, and you had your friends help you with the cruising afterwards. So you had your own custom-made crew. Now during World War I, there was a lot of boat building that went on in the state. We never really made huge vessels like battleships or anything, but we made a lot of smaller yachts and patrol craft throughout that time frame. And this shows a boat that was built by Dachel Carter Boat Company over in Benton Harbor, Michigan. And it was designed to look like a military vessel, and oftentimes private individuals would have these boats built and then would transfer them to the Navy for use in patrolling the Great Lakes waters. So it would liberate other boats to be used on the war fronts. Two of the most important individuals in Michigan's boat building history are Gar Wood and Chris Smith. Now you wouldn't think of it, but the man that's actually sitting on top of the boat there, Gar Wood, was a millionaire. And he made his fortune by building the hydraulic hoist lifts for dump trucks. And the man that's standing beside him down lower is Christopher Columbus Smith. And he was an old-time boat builder in the St. Clair River area down by Algonac, who was a decoy carver early on, but got into building small boats. And some of the small boats that he built were equipped with powerful engines. And he established a racing career through Gar Wood, who would buy the boats and then race them. And they became very, very famous as a team. Gar Wood actually won the Gold Cup, which was the American Powerboat Association trophy for Bassett's Boats on Water, and also the Harmsworth International, or British International Trophy, starting from 1920 and winning it continuously through about 1933. And they set the world water speed record with Michigan-built boats all during this time. And they really, between the two men, they really popularized boating a lot during this time frame. They made fast runabout boats that the public wanted. This is one of the last racing boats that Chris Mill and others built for Garwood. This is Garwood and his mechanic Orland Johnson in Miss America 10. And this boat had four aircraft type marinized engines that were made by Packard Company. And this boat would go 130 miles an hour on water and set the world water speed record numerous times. And this boat still survives to this day. You can see it at different boat shows and things like that. But it has enough power, as much power as three locomotives. And this would be, of course, steam locomotives for its time. But still a lot of horsepower packed into a 40-foot long boat.
Do speedboats go that fast, too?
Pardon?
Do speedboats go that fast?
Yeah, yeah. This is, you know, this is 1932, 33, right in that area. Now, Chris Smith and Garwood eventually part ways. This is Chris Smith. He goes on to become Chris Craft Corporation. And they became famous by building popular boats for families. Garwood, on the other hand, built boats for wealthier individuals that were more oriented towards racing. And so they both started their own boat companies, kind of going in two different directions. But this shows an early Chris Craft 22-foot runabout with the engine in the center. Then you've got passenger seating both forward and aft of the engine. And usually a pretty powerful engine. And then the gas tank way at the stern there. So it's sort of a cutaway view of what the boats looked like at that time. He built a factory down in Algonac and became, with the help of numerous other people, the world's largest builder of boats in the whole country, in fact, in the world. And this is the plant that was started down in Algonac. And you see different individuals doing different jobs. One person is putting a waterproof layer of fabric in between two layers of mahogany that form the hull. Another guy is working with powered screwdrivers to put in the screw fasteners, usually brass fasteners, on the plugs of the hull. But with the help of A.W. McCurr, who was one of his employees and superintendent of construction, they figured out how to cut the costs consecutively of all the different boats that they built and became very, very efficient at what they did. One of the other important designers at this time was a guy by the name of John L. Hacker. And he had no formal training in boat design, but the company that he founded, the Hacker Boat Company, still lives on to this day, only it's in upstate New York. But he had a real solid eye for design, and some of his boats were really beautiful and very, very fast for the time. One of the boats that he designed was one called the Belle Isle Bearcat, named after Belle Isle down in Detroit. But this is actress Peggy Wood sitting at the helm of the boat. And these are real fast runabouts that he designed, again, in the 1920s, early 1920s, on up through the late 1930s. Another company that his son actually helps form was called Century Boat Company up in Manistee, Michigan. And he was joined by another man from Bay City area here, George Glenn Eddy, to help form that company. And this is a Hacker designed Century Thunderbolt, a smaller racing craft, I think, from the 151 cubic inch class. Now another factor in promoting boat building at this time was Prohibition. Who wanted boats? Well, it was guys who wanted to haul liquor across the Detroit River, and also the law enforcement agencies who wanted to chase them down. And so it was kind of an arms race, if you will, that led to the growth of boat manufacturing in Michigan, particularly in the southeast. Now, the Detroit River was only about a mile wide at Detroit, of course, and some of the places downriver. And there were plenty of places to hide behind islands, and you could get across the river in about 5 minutes in a fast boat. And here you see just a little outboard powered boat that a guy is looking for a signal from the other side of the river on when it's safe to cross when there's no law enforcement boats in sight. And it was said that some 75% of the alcohol that came into the United States came across from Canada across the Detroit River. And it was that kind of volume. It leads to the growth of the Purple Gang and organized crime also. Now, here you see one of those poor, unfortunate smaller vessels that was overtaken by law enforcement agencies and people throwing the boxes of alcohol over the side. And it's been on the bottom of the Detroit River ever since, kept in a cool, dark place. So, you know, any scuba divers that are kind of interested in such things, it's still probably down there, you know. This is a shot showing the DeFault Boat and Motor Works here in town. It's real interesting because they were building both large luxury yachts for people like the auto barons, people who manage automobile companies, but also building small, fast runabouts for under subcontract with Horace Dodge. And those are the boats that you see down in the foreground. You may not know about the Horace Dodge connection, but DeFault was actually building little boats as well as the bigger yachts in the 1920s. And they were also building rum chasers for the federal government as part of that whole thing. So they were doing everything at this time. They were building in steel, they were building in wood, and became one of the largest companies in this region for cruiser building. Well, the other people from Bay City here is Ben Huskin. And Huskin Boat Works got started by, I think, his father, John Huskin. But he became a very famous boat builder. And one of the boats that he built here in town was designed in Bay City was designed by John Hacker and then built here in town. And that boat is called Thunderbird. And it's called the 70 mile an hour cocktail lounge. And you can still ride on this boat over at Lake Tahoe. And it was has this whole upper superstructure that was made of stainless steel. And then the mahogany hull that you see here, it can be preserved for weddings and things like that. But it was built right here. Another innovation that happened right in this area was a guy by the name of Charles Stiver, who was actually president of Saginaw Shipbuilding Company. Later got into building canoes out of magnesium. And this was actually before World War II started. And so Michigan was sort of the beginning area for lightweight metal boats, aluminum and magnesium. And so Stiver gets started as an elder gentleman in his 60s, building boats out of magnesium that was produced by Dow. Sold about 100 of them before he went out of business, and then he dies in 1941. So we never saw his idea come to fruition, but it led later on to the whole birth of lightweight aluminum boats in this region. This is one of the ads for Stiver early on, where he's making the boats out of Dow metal, which is an alloy of magnesium. And I love this article because it says it's even safe for children to use this boat. You know, it's never going to deteriorate. There's no canvas, no wood to deteriorate. Easy to handle. Can't sink even when it's filled with water. You know, you see the guy holding it over his head. You know, it doesn't get any better than this. But again, built right in this area. During World War II, Michigan was really important in terms of the effort to build boats that helped defend the country and also help with the invasion of Europe and the Pacific Islands. If it wasn't for Michigan-built landing craft that were primarily built by Chris-Craft, we wouldn't have been able to have the invasion of Normandy or even the Pacific Islands. A lot of what they built were the landing craft you see on the left-hand side of the picture here called the LCVP, or landing craft vehicle or personnel. And it would carry about 40 or 50 guys and then drop them off on the beach. This shows one of the plants, so again, that Dagel Carter Shipbuilding Corporation down in Benton Harbor. And they were building mine sweepers and mine layers. They were building air sea rescue boats, anything that was kind of on the smaller side, because we're sort of landlocked here in Michigan. We could only get our boats out through either the Welland Canal through Canada or through the Chicago Drainage Canal that feeds into the Mississippi River. And so we built a few things like submarines and patrol boats and things like that, but nothing ever really huge. We were kind of landlocked in that sense. But it was still real important for the workers who were oftentimes people, women that were just starting out in the plants after the men had gone off to war. And they were learning all kinds of new skills like welding, electrician work or plumbing, even hull fasteners and things like that at the different factories throughout Michigan. Here in town, they invented a process called the Defoe rollover, where they figured out it was easier to build a ship upside down by welding downwards than it was to weld upwards to build the hull. And they put the ship on big rollers and then turned it over right side up to finish the inside of the ship. And so this was a process that saved a lot of time and money in terms of shipbuilding just here in Bay City. This is the launch of one of those different patrol boats. This is a steel-hulled submarine chaser called PC-451. A lot of the ships in this area were all side-launched into the rivers because it was easy to do it that way. And it was known as the Big Splash, and the whole company and family members would come out to watch a launching. And it was a big event. A lot of times censorship ended up kind of slowing down that recognition of what was going on, but they still had big events for each launch. One of the ships that was built here in Bay City was a destroyer escort, which was lost at Normandy on D-Day, called Destroyer Escort Ridge. And it was one of those that was built here in town. Another important little company in this area is Eddie Shipbuilding Corporation. Again, they built small patrol boats and air sea rescue boats and also just harbor craft. Somebody had to tow all those landing craft around within the harbors, and they would build boats like this to tow them around. The company got its start in the 1930s, but lasted through the war, but loses out contracts after the war ended. And that's happened to a lot of different Michigan manufacturers. If you think about the different things that boat builders had to contend with after the war, there were material shortages, such as you couldn't find enough plywood or steel. There was material selection that created a challenge. Did you go to fiberglass boats? Fiberglass was, again, a product that kind of came out of the war effort. Or did you use molded plywood, which is another technique? And then finally, there's the automotive styling changes. You see here a boat on the right-hand side built up by Cadillac that was called the Cadillac Sea Lark, which is a boat trying to imitate a jet with the tall tail fins and the curved cockpit styling and things like that. This was a wooden-hulled boat. Sometimes they had fiberglass tops on them, but it was built for the Evinrude Lark outboard motor as a design idea. And the design for this boat was done by Brooks Stevens, who was an industrial designer. A lot of the Michigan boat builders looked to the automotive industry for industrial designers to help style the boats to make them look like something other than what had been built in the past. And we also have Defoe Shipbuilding, survived the war, got through it just fine. They tried to get back into building large pleasure yachts. This was, I think, a 104, 106 foot yacht called Blue Boat that they had designed shortly before the war, our American entrance into the war. But they built only about five or six or so of these particular boats before they decided that they couldn't make enough money at it to support it long term. And so they go into more commercial boat building after this point. So around 1946, 47, all these different boat builders that made all this money on war contracts suddenly started going by the wayside. Eddie Shipbuilding got into making Quonset huts that he found on a lot of college campuses. And Garwood Inc. Had again gone to the industrial stylist to try and find what kind of boats it should build. And they end up getting out of the boat building business altogether by 1948 or so. And then others like Chris Craft went on to grow and prosper. So it was all over the place in terms of how people reacted. We even had boat builders up in the Upper Peninsula. This is a boat that was built by T. Dale Vinet. Vinet Boat Works built the ferry that went out to Isle Royale. And it's one of the boats that they built. They also built commercial fishing boats and also some larger cruisers, all out of steel. Vinet was an old Navy diver who had learned his underwater welding skills in ship repair. Down in St. Charles, Michigan, we had a company called Aerocraft Boats, or Harwell Inc., as it was known, that built aluminum boats. And the founders of that company, last names of Harkins and Wiltsey, merged their names to create Harwell, actually were guys who learned aluminum fabrication methods in the aircraft building industry. They worked for Briggs Manufacturing Company down in Detroit building boats for things like bombers and other kinds of airplanes, and learned how to manufacture different types of products out of aluminum. And they transferred that industry over to St. Charles after working for Dow Chemical for a little bit. Dow was building, again, magnesium boats, and they took that industry and made it into one of the largest recreational boat manufacturers of its time, building aluminum boats down in St. Charles. This is an experimental boat that they came up with the design for. This was at the St. Charles Museum, but it was an outboard powered cruiser. Again, lightweight metal and kind of a different form, not exactly pretty, but but they tried. Others went into building fiberglass boats. Dan Arena was a boat racer who actually built fiberglass boats down in Mount Clemens, Michigan. And they became very fast, very powerful boats, and also quite expensive. But there's an interesting design that emerged out of this area. It had, again, the automotive styling with the tail fins and the wraparound windshield, things like that, that you would see on cars. Another important boat builder over in Grand Rapids, Michigan, was Wagemaker Company. And Wagemaker got its start as a furniture manufacturing firm back in the 1890s and decided to diversify in the 1930s into building boats. And so they came up with the idea of making molded plywood boats, boats that took essentially sheets of plywood and then formed them by using big presses with lots of pressure to bend that plywood into different kinds of shapes. And it was particularly useful for building a really sturdy boat hull form, like you see here. And Wagemaker also tried going in other directions, too. They formed Cadillac Marine and Boat Company up in Cadillac, Michigan, to build aluminum boats. They formed a fiberglass boat building company in Frankfort, New York, called Empire Boats. And then Wagemaker itself ends up going to Cadillac after it loses part of its plant in a fire in about 1960. And so this is one example of a boat builder that went in all kinds of different directions for its materials after the war. Century Boat Company, that same company that John A. Hacker and George Eddy formed earlier on up in Manistee, was still around. It became a very large boat building firm that, again, capitalized on using automotive type styling for its boats. And you see the vinyl covered roof and the fiberglass upper body in a lot of instances mixed with the wooden hull of a traditional boat later on. but became a real popular form of boat. Century became known as a leading form of ski boat manufacturer for a number of years. There's also little companies that formed along the Michigan and Indiana boat building, or Michigan and Indiana border to build boats. Aqua Swan was down by White Pigeon and was a little aluminum boat manufacturer, but it sort of caught on with the growth of the recreational vehicle industry down around Mishawaka and South Bend, those northern Indiana, southern Michigan cities. There's a whole band of recreational vehicle activity in that area, and boating was part of that. He first said boat companies that could be built out in the middle of a farm field, for instance, and you could ship the boats by truck as opposed by water or by rail to different port cities or different places where they could be sold like stores. Another important individual in Michigan was Les Stoddicker of Kokalin, who was a hydroplane builder and one of the most famous people in the country for building really high-speed boats. There is the boat called Shanty One being constructed up in his shop. He was actually a church pew builder who had learned how to mold large pieces of wood into different curved forms that were ideal for boat design later on. And Stoddicker also experimented with things like jet engines. He would use jet engines on different boats that he powered. One of them almost cost him his life. He was testing it out on Hubbard Lake up in northern Michigan, and a rudder let go at about 250 miles an hour. And he was able to emerge from the boat, but he broke both legs and an arm and other injuries. But that's what you do when you're trying to experiment with things. So sometimes you are successful and other times you fail. But this is a boat called Such Crust. Schaefer Bread Company, the bakers down in Detroit, had Such Crust Bread. This is the sponsors of Such Crust 3. And again, they would take post-war war surplus aircraft engines to power these boats and attain really high speeds with them. This is what they call a three-pointer. And they would throw up a spray behind the boat called a rooster tail for a shape. And was some of the fastest boats in the world that were built at this time. Another individual on the west side of the state was Leon Slickers, who got into fiberglass boat manufacturing. Here you see the Slickcraft Boat Company plant in 1968 with all the different boats coming out the assembly line. And they had learned that fiberglass was a lot easier to use than wood or any other kind of product for making distinctive curved forms and in lots of different shapes and sizes. And so Slickcraft becomes very successful, but later ends up being bought out by AMF, the Olin equipment manufacturer, and became AMF Slickcraft. So he goes with the new corporation, and a lot of these boat builders in Michigan are bought out by big conglomerates like AMF. And the guys tend to lose control of their own companies. Slickers decides that he doesn't like that so much, and he decides to go back out on his own building boats with a company called S2 Yachts. He was prohibited under his contract from starting up in power boating, so he decided to go into sailboat manufacturing. S2 stands for Slickers Part 2 as S2 Yachts. And this is one of the sailboats that he built at that time. He's still around today and building boats as Tierra Yachts. This is what the boats look like today. He was able to get back into power boating after a number of years. But this is, again, built over in Holland, Michigan, on the west side of the state, and a very prominent power boat manufacturer in Michigan at this time. Another important company in Michigan was Four Winds Boats up in Cadillac, Michigan. And the Wynn family, W-Y-N-N, had couple of brothers who were salesmen for another company called Spicer Works. And Spicer was getting up in years and wanted to sell out his company. So he told the two Wynn brothers that either you buy the company or you're fired. And so they bought the company with Dad's help. Dad was a motorcycle company vice president for BSA Motorcycles, and he provided the finances behind the company. And they went on to become Four Winds Boats. And to this day is one of the larger boat manufacturers in the state. Tom Gorse, the fellow who won the Detroit Pistons, owned this company, I think, up until fairly recently. And then it was bought out by Beneteau Boats, I think, last year, which was a French firm. Another important builder was Sea Ray Boats, which got its start down in Oxford, Michigan, just south of Lapeer a little bit. And they were known for the way that they designed the boat interiors, and that's how they became famous. They spent a lot of time trying to figure out what people would want to see on the inside of the boat. If you can imagine, older boats were pretty empty on the inside. They had a couple of seats that were mounted in it, but not much for decoration or styling or anything else. So they figured out how to build the inside of the boat, and then high-speed, high-powered boats like the one you see here, sometimes brightly painted, to become a famous boat building firm. This is a billion-dollar industry nowadays at Sea Ray. They're no longer in Michigan. They moved out of state down to the south, but Chris Craft and a number of the other ones, again, leave the Rust Belt and moved to Florida, where it's a little cheaper to manufacture the boats. They didn't have the union issues like we did in Michigan. But they become famous in other parts of the country. And so this is an example of Sea Ray and fast boats of that time. Now, wooden boat building never really goes away. This is the Great Lakes Boat Building School up in Cedarville, up in the Upper Peninsula. I had the opportunity to talk with their graduating class last summer of new boat builders that were just coming off into the industry, learning how to build boats by both traditional methods, but also by using different techniques like epoxy-based hulls. So the Goujon brothers here in town were important in boat building history for developing the epoxies, the West system for bonding wooden materials together to repair old boats, but also to build new ones. They built the DN-60 ice boats that became famous, as well as trimarans. I was talking with Frank Starkweather down in front here, who used to work for the farm earlier this afternoon. But to this day, very important fabricators of the materials for boat building. And again, get started right in this area. Boat building is still very much a family tradition. This is a shot of Steve and Ben Van Dam up in Boyne City, Michigan, building boats about 30 years ago. The little boy that you see standing next to his dad is now the project manager for the firm. And they're still building custom-made runabouts, high-end runabouts of different forms, like you see in the photo here. And then finally, I'd like to talk a little bit about the importance of libraries. And you came to the word library here on purpose, but all kinds of different records that you can find at places like this. We have things like the census records, Michigan State Gazetteer and Business Directories. I was able to go through a bunch of old volumes of that from the 1870s on up through 1930s to pick out different boat builders and where they worked and how long they lasted and things like that. There's also things like the Sanmore insurance maps, which show the layout of different buildings and what the buildings were made of. There's a lot of the old boating magazines that you can find online now and read it from a leisure for your sofa, like I did. And finally, there's oral histories that are collected by different individuals. A lot of times, folks that have been in the industry for a long time reflect on what they have done. There's also records at local historical societies and also libraries. And don't be afraid to ask for help when you're doing that kind of research. That pretty much concludes my presentation, and I'd like to entertain any questions.
Thank you. Any questions I can try and answer? Yes?
I was just looking at the different types of boats that you show, and I wondered where they manufactured tugboats.
Tugboats are kind of built by, a lot of times by larger shipbuilding firms, but they make a few down in Fort Huron and the Detroit area especially. Sometimes it was made by companies like the Great Lakes Engineering Works and shipbuilding firms. But there's even Inland River tugboats that are built way during the lumber industry, early on, like side wheel tugboats for dragging towed logs up to the sawmills. So all over the place. Yes?
Not really a question, but when I was a little girl, my parents would say, when I lived out in the country by Chesapeake, and there was always houseboats sitting on the side of the river by the bridges. Now, do they build them themselves or what?
No, I don't know. There was a little cluster of them that was written about in a boating magazine from like 1905. And this is right near the...
Why not that old?
Yeah, no, I didn't.
Well, this was
but it was an old tradition of having houseboats that were built just as residences right by the mouth of the Tittabawassee and Saginaw.
Really?
Yeah.
These were by the Center Row Bridge.
Okay, right, yeah, right. So more here in town, yeah. Yeah, a lot of times they would be built by like the smaller builders, the Van Husken kind of people. Sometimes they were home built by individuals. Sometimes they would take an old barge and convert it into a houseboat. All sorts of different things. There was actually a company down in Detroit that manufactured houseboats, but it starts in like 1929, and right at the height of the Great Depression, or at the start of the Great Depression, and folds a couple of years later. But they built, I think it was called American Boat Corporation houseboats.
Where did you say the one on the Tittabawassee River, did you say?
Yeah, yeah. This one article I'm referring to was like 1905, and there was a little colony of houseboats that were right up at the junction of the Tittabawassee and Saginaw, as I recall.
Oh, this was in the, when we were going into the city of Saginaw, across one of the bridges.
It's Center Road. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
My grandma lived by there.
Oh, houseboats.
Okay.
Yeah. My dad used to... one of the guys who lived there, his name was Chummy LaPorte.
Okay.
And my dad used to go there, he would tell me, and swim there, and the water was clear.
Yeah. Clear, beautiful. Your backyard.
Not in the 1950s, it wasn't.
Yeah. You know, it's not well documented that, you know, a lot of people do spend their time on the boats, and it was, you know, this year you're seasonal, but down in like Florida and all, it's a year round type of thing, where they have air conditioners on their boats and stuff like that. So, other questions I can try and answer.
This is not another question, but Stoddard's building is still right out there on Beaver Road, right off of M-13.
Yeah.
We're right by the Bay County Road Commission there.
Yeah.
And they built boats there, I would say, in the 70s yet.
Yeah, I know the business is taken over by John Stoddard, J-O-N, John Stoddard, and they even built stunt planes, aircraft, afterwards.
Well, so, my dad worked for Mobil Oil at the time. It was now Exxon Mobil.
Yeah.
And the Mobil would furnish, when Stoddard was building those race boats, they would furnish the oil for those boats and they would try them out right at the mouth of the river, and then they would take them down to Detroit and race them on the Detroit River.
Yeah.
And one of the guys, men, I should say, not guys, that owned a lot of those race boats was Guy Lombardo.
Right, yeah. All his boats were called Tempo.
Yeah. And I have five brothers, so
yeah.
One day my dad took my brothers down there, and my brothers are kind of comical anyway. At the time they stood like stair steps, and Mr. Guy Lombardo came out and looked at him and made the comment on all the brothers, and he gave each one of them a quarter, and so then on wherever they went, they stood like stair steps.
Yeah, he was quite the boat racer. He owned a number of different boats back to, some that Stoddard built were these jet boats were for people like him, and also the president of Nash Motor Company. His name is escaping me right now, but they would test out these jet engines. One of them was run by radio control out on Saginaw Bay, and it took in some water droplets and exploded the engine, and you know, that was the end of that boat. Probably still parts and pieces of it.
Well, in that restaurant down in Detroit called the Rooster
Tail,
that was not about a rooster. That was about the boat.
It was all about the boat racing. There was a big competition with folks at down in Detroit against Seattle, Washington boat builders. Mm-hmm. And there was a big competition between the two cities to see who had the fastest boats in the country. So,
yeah, you can keep taking
okay.
Yeah. Can you read The Boys in the Boat?
I have not yet, but it's on my list.
Yeah, that's a
I tend to, I read a lot of the old boating magazines because I'm still, this is a hobby interest for me. I've been collecting information for about 30 years now on just old boat builders. And just in this area, in Bay City alone, there's like 50 or 60 different boat builders. You probably never heard of the John Arnold Steel Boat Company, but there was a little company that built steel boats here in town for a little bit. One was called Secret Boat Works. Charles Trudell was a boat builder here in town who built a boat called the Secret, which was a real fast boat for its time. And later on, he renamed the company as Secret Boat Works. And so it's a real interesting to me topic of how people evolved over time. A lot of engine builders up this way, too. There was Smalley Motor Company and Erd Motor Company and Stork Motor Company, which really helped promote those early racing boats in this area. And so that's how it kind of kicks off in this area locally. So, any other questions? Yeah.
Not a question, but my husband uses Gujian glue all the time, so it's the best there is.
As well, he should. So, yeah, I was just at a boat restoration shop where they, you know, use that the same product, the West System product, for doing repairs on new hulls. You know, it's kind of a end-all, be-all solution. You know, you can't undo it once you've done it to a certain extent. But
I'm in the Merchant Marine, and I've always worked on big ships. And then this last summer, my wife and I, we bought a 1961 Cruisers Incorporated boat. And we're looking to restore it and everything, and I'm kind of learning everything now. And the hull is very solid and everything, but there is a little bit towards the transom where there's a couple of, you know.
Weak areas or
separation. And so is that Gujian there the ones to see about strengthening, like planking?
Yeah, I probably go there and, you know, ask for some advice. Again, I study more of the boat building history, not the boat building itself. But, you know, so I don't know a lot about the boat construction per se, but yeah, I did stop in the shop there because I see if they have some place for us.
Do you have time for one more question?
I have another comment.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, my husband just repaired the Blessed Virgin statue in our church with Gujian glue.
Did your husband work there?
No.
Did you bring one to sell to us?
Oh, no.
And you had one question?
Well, mine was another question about the Gujians. What did they do before the epoxy thing? Were they already a boat building company?
Yeah, they kind of get their start. Correct me if I'm wrong on this, they built ice boats. It was called the DN-60. It stands for Detroit News. There is a design for Detroit News published back in the 1930s for ice boats, and it becomes a pretty hot thing here in Michigan and throughout the upper Midwest to race boats on ice. You know, it's not boat building per se, but they get their start building these DN-60 ice boats. The 60, I think, refers to the square footage of the sail. And then they get into building trimarines, three-hull boats, essentially, sailboats, and, you know, three things. So, and then my understanding, and I'd have to check my facts on this, but I think they learned about using epoxy from a guy by the name of Victor Carpenter, who worked down in Montrose, Michigan, and he had learned a term from guys in the GM shops, they would use these glues or epoxies to bond numerous pieces of mahogany together to make patterns for castings. Anyway, yep, well, what is worth it? But thank you all for attending today. I really do.
Thank you.
Next week, we'll have Tom Conway, who will be reviewing the book, Buildings of Michigan. So we'll see you again next week. Thank you for coming.